This video is about the cassette tape.
I miss cassettes. I miss all this hiss. I miss the wow and flutter.
Cassettes are back from the dead.
Normally, I think unboxing videos are stupid, but this time I'm willing to make an exception because this is something you won't see every day. It's a new cassette deck, and I don't mean new as in new old stock from 30 years ago. I mean new as in a new model that was just introduced in 2018. It's the TASCAM 202 Mark 7. And yes, that's how you're supposed to say that, Mark 7.
The 202 Mark 7?
TASCAM is the professional division of TEAC Corporation, and cassette decks have been a mainstay of their product line since the beginning. But when their previous model, the 202 Mark 6, was discontinued in 2016, I thought that was the end of the line for TASCAM making cassette decks, because since then they've only offered a combination CD player and single cassette deck. That's the CD-A580. But for 2018 they brought back a double cassette deck, as you can see there. And this is actually based on the TEAC W-1200, which is so far only sold in Japan. So unlike some of the previous versions of the TASCAM 202, TEAC does not sell an equivalent consumer-grade version of this cassette deck in the USA. It's made in China, no surprise there, and I believe that's the production date, 1804-23, which would be April 23rd of 2018. And since I thought it would be appropriate, I'm actually recording this video on tape. I'm using my Canon HV20 camcorder, recording 1080i HD video onto one of these little things, a mini DV video cassette. So let's get on with the unboxing. This was shipped to me in this box, but it looks like it survived without too much damage. And TEAC or TASCAM did not send this to me. This is not a sponsored video. I paid for this with my own money. I'll talk more about that later, because you may be in for a little bit of sticker shock when you find out how much this thing costs. Right on top here, we have the owner's manual for remote and batteries, and the cassette deck. Nothing else in the box. All right, power cord is permanently attached. So here it is. It also includes rack mounting screws. And these rack mounting brackets can be removed if you don't intend to use them. They extend the full depth of the unit, so they look quite sturdy. And compared to the previous generation model, the 202 Mark 6, the Mark 7 does remove a couple features. It no longer has auto reverse and no longer has high speed dubbing, but most cassette experts would recommend you never use those features anyway, because every time you flip the heads around to play the other side on an auto reverse deck, it tends to knock them slightly out of alignment. And also, of course, high speed dubbing degrades the audio quality even more than normal dubbing does. But the Mark 7 does add some new features. It has a so-called special playback mode, which lets you play one cassette deck through the line outputs and simultaneously play the other deck through the headphone output, so you can cue up one tape while you're playing another. Also has a USB output on the back for converting your cassettes into digital format. And as you have already seen, it includes a remote control now. And it also includes a level control for the headphone jack. And the most interesting to me is the new noise reduction feature, which TASCAM says is equivalent to Dolby B noise reduction, although it's only for playback, as you can see. Because in late 2014, TEAC and TASCAM no longer offered any new cassette decks with Dolby noise reduction. And I actually emailed them to ask them why, and they said it's because Dolby no longer licenses their noise reduction system. So I'm quite interested to see how much of an equivalent this is to Dolby B noise reduction as TASCAM claims it is. In terms of other features this deck has, it has full logic controls, as you can see, and it has dual recording, so you can actually record whatever is coming into the input to two tapes simultaneously. And actually looks like both decks now have a return to zero feature, even though TASCAM says only deck 2 has it. So that looks like a mistake in their specifications. And what that does, it automatically rewinds or fast forwards until the counter returns to zero. Also includes a dimmer, which dims the display. Oh, there's actually multiple levels. That's nice. There's a repeat feature, which lets you mark the beginning and end of a section of the tape, and it'll automatically repeat play that section, I believe, up to 10 times. There's the parallel recording I was talking about. There's the button for the dubbing feature, which, as I said, it's only normal speed dubbing. There's no more high speed dubbing. You get a microphone input with adjustable level control, adjustable recording level. There's the headphone jack with the level control, which is another new feature. Deck 1 has a pitch control, which I believe can vary the pitch up to plus or minus 12%. There's a timer feature, just like pretty much any cassette deck ever made. That's where if you use an external timer to apply power, if you turn on the switch, it'll automatically start recording or playing when power is applied. When you turn it on, it says 202 Mark 7, and then the level meter appears. Curiously, the level meter still has the Dolby symbol in it, even though this no longer has the capability to record with Dolby noise reduction, although that's probably because it's just using the same display from previous generations of the 202. And the remote control duplicates most of the front panel controls, even including the dimmer, which actually has 5 settings. I counted them. There's the controls for parallel recording and dubbing, and your banks of controls for tape 1 and tape 2. Now, the elephant in the room that must be addressed is the type of mechanism this deck uses. It's made by a company called Tanashin, and if you want to make a cassette deck these days, this is it. This is pretty much your only choice for a mechanism you can use. It's basically the same thing that they've been using in boomboxes and entry-level stereo systems and cassette decks ever since 1986, which is when Tanashin started making cassette deck mechanisms. And the performance and specifications are really not any worse than an entry-level double cassette deck from 20 or 30 years ago, but it's definitely not as good as the high-end cassette decks from the glory days of the format in the 80s and 90s, including TASCAM's own previous models. So it is a rather cheap mechanism, but the good thing is it's very simple, and these are actually known to be quite reliable because of their simplicity, and they're supposed to be easy to service. The belts are easy to replace. And since they made so many of these, the parts are pretty much totally interchangeable. It is true AC bias recording of AC bias erase, so it's not a permanent magnet erase head. And like any other deck that uses this mechanism, it can play all the tape types, but it can only record onto type 1 and type 2 tapes. It cannot record onto type 4 metal tapes. And this does have automatic tape type selection for both decks. Now, the reason why these decks don't support recording onto metal tape is because metal tape requires a higher bias level than chrome or standard tape. That bias level is probably higher than what the recording head on this deck is capable of, so that's why it's not supported. And if you tried to do it anyway, it would make a recording, but it probably wouldn't sound very good because the bias would be wrong. And in reality, most people never used metal tapes because they're very expensive, so it's not something you're going to encounter every day. And here is a look at the back of the deck. You get your typical line in and line out jacks, the USB output. There's a voltage selector switch, so this is worldwide voltage and frequency. You can use it on 120 or 230 volts, 50 or 60 hertz. So let's pop in a tape just to see how the mechanism sounds and feels. Nice soft eject, it's not too slow, not too fast. No, that doesn't really matter that much, but it's nice to see. The counter appears when you put in a tape. I like that. Nice, fast, responsive controls. There's the level meter, and it is a true stereo level meter. It's not like some decks where it looks like a stereo meter, but it's both the same for left and right channels combined. This is independent left and right channel meters. It's fast forwarding, nice and quiet. Rewinding. There is no program search. It cannot automatically find the tracks on the tape. So that's a little bit of a disappointment. So when you hit fast forward, it's not searching for the next track. It's just fast forwarding, and it'll forward all the way to the end of the tape if you let it. Now let's see that return to zero feature. There it goes, rewinding. And it stopped when it reached zero. Now I'll put one tape playing in the deck number one, and I'll put a tape in deck number two. And I should be able to start that playing as well. Okay, since I did not have the special playback mode turned on, deck one stopped when I started playing deck two. But now if I turn the special mode on and start deck one, now they're both playing. And you can see that one is blinking, which means I believe the deck number two is only going to play through the headphone output, while deck number one is going to play through the line output on the back, and I suppose also the USB output. Just my one little complaint is that it's rather hard to see the tape playing through the window. They do give you a little sticker on the back to reflect the light, but it's sort of a matte silver color instead of the bright orange sticker that many other cassette decks have to make it easier to see. Or even the really high-end decks have a little light in there to shine through. If you look straight through it, you can see it, and actually one thing I notice is this window is actually curved, so it sort of acts like a, I don't know what you call it, prismatic mirror or something, to sort of spread out the view and make it look bigger through the window than the actual tape is inside there. But you gotta have a pretty good amount of light shining into this, and you gotta look straight into it to see it. See, now if I look head on and turn on my camcorder's light, then you can clearly see the tape through the window. And let me try out the remote. There's playback. Fast forward, rewind, pause, and return to zero. We actually stopped at one, but I guess that's close enough. And counter reset, which reset it to zero. And here's the dimmer, that's the dimmest setting. Second, third, fourth, and brightest setting. I'm anxious to hear how this thing sounds, and I'm sure you are too, but first I pulled out my audio alignment test tape, which has a 1 kilohertz tone on it, to check the speed of this deck. You can see my frequency counter program. I have it connected to the line input of my computer. And on deck one, it's just a little bit slow, It's averaging around 997 hertz. So that's within 0.5%. You would never notice that. And this is a brand new mechanism, so it may be a little bit tight, and once it breaks in, it might actually improve to be right on the money at 1,000 hertz. So I'd say that's well within normal specifications. And the number two deck, pretty much the same thing, around 997, 998. So within 0.5% of where it's supposed to be. Now I forgot to mention the pitch control. I did have it in the center detent position when I was doing that test. So that proves the center position is pretty much correct. But of course you can vary it across a wide range. I also checked the azimuth, which is the tape head alignment by ear on both sides, using a mixer of a mono switch. So I would play the tape and I would combine the channels to mono, and if the treble response stays the same, you know the azimuth is correct. If the sound gets muffled when you switch it into mono, then you know the azimuth is misadjusted. And on both sides, it was pretty much close enough to correct that I wouldn't bother adjusting it. Although if you do want to adjust it, these doors are removable. And then when you're playing a tape, you get full access to adjustment screw here through this hole here. And to pop the door back on, it was a little tricky getting it on the first time, but there's slots you gotta line up with, and I think shouldn't be too hard to do. There we go. And as for this mysterious noise reduction feature, I've had a good listen to it, and I'm really impressed. It actually works very well to reduce the hiss and the quiet parts of the music without muffling the sound during the louder parts of the music. I wouldn't say it's an exact match for Dolby noise reduction. I think it's closer to dynamic noise reduction. And if you want to learn more about that, UXW Bill has a video about the subject in which he goes into great detail about it and provides some audio samples of its performance.
Have you ever wondered what it would be like to have music in your home? It might sound like a silly question, considering that you're probably listening to this cassette in your living room. But if you're like most music lovers, you probably believe that the music you've been listening to can't really compare to the magic of a live performance. So you've turned to new formats such as compact discs and more exotic components to try to capture some of that concert magic, all to the same end. We think it's time to put the magic back into listening to music at home.
And when you have this noise reduction enabled and you're playing a good quality chrome or metal tape, the background noise level is very low. I'm actually quite impressed by that. Although I did notice some hum on the deck number one during the quiet parts of the tape. My guess is because this side is closer to the power transformer and it's not as well shielded as it could be. So the hum from the power transformer is getting into the playback head. On deck number two, there is a very little trace amount of hum, but you gotta have it cranked up way loud in order to hear it. So on deck number two, it should not be a problem, but on deck number one, there's a little bit of hum there. So maybe TASCAM, they could add some extra shielding to that power transformer to solve that problem.
Now, here are some music selections to let you adjust and become familiar with your stereo controls.
Now, as for the playback demonstration, I have all sorts of wonderful tapes I could play for you, both new and old. But I have something really special for you, something that you probably didn't even know existed. Take a look at this. Four JBL audio systems, the sound of quality, reference standard demonstration cassette. There's the Dolby logo. Says the same thing on the front, gold metal. Duplicated in real time. So this is not a high-speed duplicated tape like virtually everything else. Duplicated in real time. And it gets even better when we look at the tape itself. Look at this. Metal bias 70 microsecond equalization. This is a Type 4 metal pre-recorded tape. something that you probably didn't even know existed. Put out by Ford Audio Systems around 1991. So we're going to use this for the playback demonstration. I popped off the cover to look inside, and there's quite a bit more going on in here than I expected. Quite a bit of circuitry. Now, there is some easily accessible controls, which is nice to see. For example, they give you trimmers to adjust the speed. That's for the deck number one, and that's for deck number two. So that is quite easy to adjust if you really want to get it finely tuned to be exactly on the correct speed. Now I can see the problem with the hum getting into the audio, because some of this audio circuitry is right up next to the power transformer. So they really should have put some metal shielding around this, and that would probably eliminate that hum. There's more adjustments here for recording level. And there's adjustments for recording bias, playback level. So there's quite a bit of adjustments here. Now this chip is probably the USB encoder, and right here in the middle of your screen is a tiny surface mount version of the National Semiconductor LM1894 Dynamic Noise Reduction Chip. So just as I suspected, the noise reduction feature of this deck is dynamic noise reduction. The cassette mechanisms are about as simple as you can possibly make these things. There's only two belts. One going from the motor to the flywheel, and another from the flywheel to this pulley right here. And the motor is on a bracket which can be unscrewed, so it looks like if you remove this bracket, you should be able to easily replace these belts, which is a nice thing. The flywheel is metal, although it has this plastic part attached to it, and that's about as much as you can say about these things. They've been simplified as much as possible over the years. And generally, the fewer parts, the less there is to go wrong. So I think it should be pretty reliable. For my recording test, I have something I've been curious to try. It's this Fuji DR2 Type 2 High Bias Chrome Tape. But it says double coating. It says two magnetic layers create clear, powerful sound with super low noise. This is kind of like what they tried to do with Type 3 tape way back in the late 70s and early 80s. They tried to combined the best features of Type 1 and Type 2 tape, and it didn't really work out that well, so I'm curious to see how this works out. It says two separate magnetic layers, upper layer for noise reduction, lower layer for high output, high quality tape and extra slim case. So let's see how this works out. There's always something special about peeling open a cassette tape that you just don't get anymore with modern media formats. So there we go. Put in our tape. And my audio source will be this CD player. And the music I will be using will be from this Pat Coyle Sheffield Lab CD. This is an audiophile quality CD. It says Reference Standard for Audiophile Excellence. It's from 1993. So overall, I'm impressed with the TASCAM 202 Mark VII. I think it performs a lot better than its specifications would suggest, and they definitely made the best of the kind of mechanisms they have to work with these days. It does have a few minor shortcomings, which I pointed out, but none of them are showstoppers by any means. So if you're in the market for a new cassette deck, I don't think many people would be, but if you happen to be, this is definitely the best one you can buy today. But remember what I said about sticker shock? Well, that's what you might get when I tell you the list price of this thing is $499.99. Now, I happen to take advantage of a one-day special 20% off eBay sale, so I only paid around $400 for this, plus sales tax, so it ended up being around $430 or so. And that's still a lot of money to spend on a new cassette deck, especially when there are plenty of really good used cassette decks with far better specifications and features than this that you can find for that kind of money. But nonetheless, maybe you don't want to take a chance on a used cassette deck. Maybe you want to have something brand new with a factory warranty on it. In that case, this is definitely your best choice. And maybe if there's enough interest, TEAC will start selling the W-1200 in North America, which is basically the consumer grade equivalent of this. The only differences I can see is that it does not have the special playback feature, and also does not come with the rack mounting ears, which you can see I've already removed from the TASCAM. So that's about it for my review of the TASCAM 202 Mark VII cassette deck. Thank you for watching, and please feel free to leave a comment if you have one.